Praise the Lord. This is the Holy Ghost Forum. I'm Gary Bailey, and these are friends of mine, ministers of the gospel, and we're going to talk to you about the move of the Spirit in the local church. Praise God. Church of Jesus Christ is a spiritual organization. It's a miraculous organization. It's a supernatural organization, meaning that what we do and what we're involved in just doesn't have to do with things of the natural. It has to do with things of the Spirit, things of heaven. And we're going to talk about these today. And specifically in this first session, we're going to talk about tongues and interpretation and proper order in the church when these gifts are in operation. So stay tuned with us. We're going to go about 30 minutes or so, then we'll have another session where we'll follow up with that. But before we get into that, I'd like to introduce those that are on the panel. To my left here is Pastor Gary Rutter. He pastors Bloodbought Church in Murraysville, PA, and we're good friends and glad to have him on the forum with us. And to his left is Pastor Marlene Levin, and she pastors International Word of Faith in Delmont, Pennsylvania. This is just east of Pittsburgh, just a few miles. And we're glad to have you, Marlene, and looking forward to your input here. And to my right is Pastor John Maruka. And he pastors, and my mind just went blank, in New Brighton, PA. And the name of your church, Victory Assembly. You've been pastoring this now for 26 years, right? Not New Brighton, but you've been in the Beaver Valley area.
Yeah, 26 years.
Yeah, 26 years. We're in wireless mics here. Let us use them here. So you've been in New Brighton now for
about 2 years. Yeah, about 2.5.
But in general, you've been in that area for 26 years.
26 years, exactly.
Yeah. So a long time. We're looking forward to your input, experience. Praise God. John's been a good friend to us, and we've been ministering. We met years ago back in the 90s, I think.
At a tent meeting.
At a tent meeting, yeah. I brought my tent down, and we had a good time down there. Did you lead worship?
Yeah,
worship.
I was just going to say, Johnny got me to lead worship.
Yeah, had a mutual friend that invited Pastor John
Marola.
Yeah, so we're glad to have you with us.
Good to be here, John.
And then to his right is Brother Rob Lairo. He's a fiery preacher and graduate of Rhema, and praise God, just moving forward in God, has a great ministry and a great move of the Spirit in his life. So we're looking forward to hearing from each and every one today. So praise God. I want to open it up with the scripture here in 1 Corinthians and chapter 14. And really, if you want information and knowledge concerning tongues and interpretation, this is the go-to chapter in the Bible. There's been so much misconstrued in this chapter and so much abuse and neglect. We hardly know really what it says. But if you'll do a good study, a close study of chapter 14, and you'll really go over with a fine-tooth comb. God has a lot of revelation, a lot of truth that we can glean from these verses. And I'm going to start here in verse 26, where Paul is telling us how a church service should function. And he begins here in verse 26. He's already spoken a lot about the gift of tongues. He's spoken about prophecy. He's talked about interpretation up to this point. He's talked about all the benefits of it. And so we get to verse 26, and he says, "How is it then, brother, when you come together, every one of you hath a song, hath a doctrine, hath a tongue, hath a revelation, hath an interpretation. Let all things be done unto edifying." Now, we could maybe argue exactly what he's saying about what is a psalm, but we know psalm has to do with singing, and everybody loves to sing in church. We love to worship in church, so this is part of it. Paul's telling us this ought to be part and parcel of any church service. Then he goes on and talks about doctrine. We're talking about teaching and preaching now. So when we come together, we ought to have teaching and preaching from the ministry, involved in the ministry. But if we're going to have church the way Paul said to have church, there's three other ingredients for a church service. And the thing about it is, we've operated 99.9% of our churches on these first two ingredients. I don't know if there's a church in America or around the world that you can go to that doesn't have singing and worship and doesn't have teaching and preaching. I mean, we just know this is how we have church. We're going to sing, we're going to worship, and we are going to teach and preach the Bible. But Paul doesn't stop with teaching and preaching. He goes on and he tells us, "Hath a tongue, hath a revelation, hath an interpretation." And this really begins talking about the Holy Spirit's involvement with the service. Now, obviously, the Holy Spirit's involved with our worship and praise. The Holy Spirit's involved with our teaching and preaching. But we definitely know these are manifestations where Paul clearly taught us in chapter 12. This is one of the nine gifts of the Spirit, actually two of the nine gifts of the Spirit, that he mentions there in chapter 12, the first part of chapter 12. And he tells us these ought to be in a church service. You say, well, why tongues interpretation? Why not have working of miracles or the gift of faith in every service? Because most of those gifts, when you talk about the other seven gifts, they're aligned with gifted individuals. When we talk about the ministry of the apostle or the prophet or the evangelist, pastor, and teacher, every one of those ministry offices is accompanied by giftings. The prophet is going to have revelation gifts. The evangelist is going to have power gifts. The teacher may have the word of wisdom or word of knowledge in operation. The pastor may have the word of wisdom or any combination of the nine gifts. So primarily when an individual comes to the church who is anointed of God, gifted of God, standing in one of the offices of this of God, he's going to come with equipment. Just like if you call a plumber comes with tools. Just like if you call a carpenter comes with a saw and hammer. You know, he comes with the necessary equipment and knowledge and expertise to do the job. And so a ministry office is going to be very similar in the sense that he comes with expertise, he comes with knowledge, and he comes with the tools to do the job. But what about tongues interpretation? Where do they come in? Why is Paul mentioning that these ought to be in the service? Well, one thing we know about tongues interpretation is they didn't operate in the Old Testament. They only operated in the New Testament. In fact, on the day of Pentecost, tongues and interpretation showed up where tongues were spoken and people understood. Now, we don't see it interpreted. We just know that people understood what was spoken. But throughout the book of Acts, throughout the New Testament, we see where tongues and interpretation and certainly the gift of prophecy were in operation. But tongues and interpretation are unique to the New Testament. Not so we can just shove them in a corner someplace and neglect them and not use them, but tongues interpretation is for the church, for the church service, and for us to operate on a very consistent basis. In fact, tongues interpretation ought to be in operation in our churches more so than any of the other seven gifts in the Spirit, or the rest of the seven gifts. So, I don't know if anyone else has something. Just jump in here if you want to add to what I'm saying. We'll continue on down here. But we need to see these gifts in the church. We need to see them operate. We need to see them function. And Paul gives us a good reason to have them. He puts them right here in the list. When we come together, these things are to operate. Of course, we've already covered this in some other sessions, but sometimes people wait and say, oh, well, if the Spirit moves me. No, we got to step out in faith. These things don't operate without faith. And faith, it takes some initiative. I don't know, Rob, do you have some experience along that line where you just stepped out in faith?
Many a times during a service, the unction would come, what I believe is an unction to give a tongue. But at first I was afraid. Just downright ridiculous. What will somebody think if it's not done right? And just by faith, I just stepped forward, raised my hand, and the pastor acknowledged me, and I gave the tongue, and what he interpreted with was pure edification for the church. Just exhortations, and it just went very, very well. And then we got to a place where got to be a connection, a flow between the two of us, like my brother David back here and I would in the prison, we would give tongues and interpretations also.
Now, let me ask you this, Rob. When you stepped out and spoke in a tongue, did you feel goosebumps? Did you feel any kind of leading whatsoever? I mean, maybe sometimes yes, sometimes no, or?
No, it was, my hands are sweating, my forehead is sweating because you're just nervous. But once I released it, I thought, well, that was easy because I didn't have to interpret it.
Yeah.
The interpreter interpreted. And it went very well, and it got real easy to give a tongue when I sensed that unction on the inside. It's not something physical. It's you learn the Holy Ghost and you just know that it's almost like you know your own name. Just know something is fine.
Yeah.
But what I'd like to say, Gary, is whenever after I'm preaching and after I'm finished, then like the unction comes to God has something else to add to it by the Holy Ghost. Or sometimes when I'm in the service, even if I'm not preaching, I sense He has a word. So wherever it will fit appropriate, He has a word at some time, you know, during the meeting.
What I want to clarify, though, is, you know, we talk about the unction. We talk about, sensing something. But that doesn't necessarily mean anything to people. You know, what is the unction? What is that feeling? My point is, these are to operate. Mm-hmm. We need to step out in faith.
Yeah.
Regardless of how strong that unction is. I mean, sometimes it may be very strong, sometimes not so strong. But just simply obeying the Scripture, stepping out and letting these gifts be part of the service.
There has been times when I've come to church, and it was almost like I had the unction while I was driving down the road. But when I got here, it just seemed like there was nothing. So when the opportunity came, step forward and release the tongue, sure enough, pastor interpreted.
you brought up a great point. I want you to elaborate a little bit on it. Sometimes you can have, you know that the Holy Spirit wants to say something, but you didn't give it right away. I've heard of even people and of doing this a week later. They yep. might have something this Sunday. Like, for instance, the proper order we get in verse 27 is only three can give forth a tongue in a service. Three individuals.
Right.
But what if the fourth one feels an unction? Well, they just have to wait till next week. Elaborate a little bit on that, Rob.
We have a sort of order here that if you have a tongue, there's a time when it's good to give it. But yet, during the service, Pastor and I have brought forth tongues at times right in the middle of the service. There's that, it's there. I can stand up, put my hand up, and if he acknowledges me, it's brought forth. And yet other times I've stood up and actually gave a tongue and he didn't interpret it. And there's nothing wrong with that because he's the head in the service. He's the interpreter of the service. He didn't bring it forth, that's okay.
One thing I want to mention here, and maybe Pastor Gary can elaborate on this, there is a different order that applies to the congregation as right. opposed to applying to leadership right. or quote-unquote the prophets in the church.
Right.
And basically we're just talking about the ministry offices or ministry gifts. Pastor Gary, you want to? Okay.
Saying, just adding to that, you know, usually the pastor will give the tongues if he feels the message, you know, to bring it forth. Then I will come out in tongues and interpret. But as you were saying, and Rob was saying, in the congregation, a way decent. In order, decently, and in order is to raise their hand, and then whoever's speaking up here is the interpreter. Is that right? What you're saying?
When we get in the next verse, we're going to talk about mm-hmm. the one interpreter.
Right.
I got stuck here on verse 26, but give you another chance, Gary. Anything you want to add right now?
I always. Feel that God wants to move. Something needs to be added. There's something that needs to happen, but they don't know what it is. I say, give a tongue. You don't have to know what it is because it's an unknown tongue. You know, only thing you know is God wants to insert himself into this meeting. And if you know that, give a tongue. And I have accepted the responsibility from God to interpret any tongues that we have. So that's what I do. A little bit further down in verse 32, it says, the spirit of the prophets is subject to the prophets. And when we get saved, we get filled with the Holy Ghost, a lot of times that's an emotional effect. You get the goosebumps and the hot flashes and the chills and the vibrations, all kinds of, there's many different people, that's how many different experiences there are, but we're not moved by experiences. They accompany a move of God sometimes. We're moved by faith, we're moved by the word of God, and the spirit of the prophet is subject to the prophet. So it's up to you if you speak in tongues or not. And if you don't, that was your decision, not you. And if you do, that was your decision, too. If the Holy Ghost doesn't force people to speak in tongues, it's a gift. If you don't want to use it, then most people don't use it, quite frankly. But some people do. Praise the Lord. Somebody needs to. It's a gift
that is given to bless you, to bless the church, to bless the service. When you're having a church service and somebody gives a tongue, the whole congregation comes to attention, and it's a moment of faith. And everybody in hearing range of that tongue has to decide, am I going to believe or am I going to doubt? And it calls your attention to faith right there. And if the congregation is given to believing, and you know God's about to say something, listen up. It'll ratchet up your service. It'll take it up a notch. It just brings faith in the room up a notch, and everything has a stronger anointing. On the other hand, that's a gift that you don't have to use. So if you choose not to use it, then faith doesn't go up a notch. The anointing doesn't go up a notch. And the whole service is business as usual.
You know, a lot of churches and a lot of people choose not to use the gifts. But what I think is very interesting at the end of 1 Corinthians chapter 14, after Paul writes all this, he says, I want you to know something. He says, the things that I'm writing to you are the commandments of the Lord. Now, we don't have to obey it. I mean, he's not forcing our hands to have this gift in our church, but, you know, at some point we ought to pay attention to what the Bible says. And one other thing I want to add about that is this public gift of tongues with interpretation, it's the same in operation as your private tongue, only a different purpose. Now, when I say same in operation, you might pray quietly under your breath, or you might pray out loud in an empty church walking back and forth. But essentially, Paul said this. What is it then? I will pray with the Spirit. I will pray with the understanding. I will sing with the Spirit. I will sing with the understanding. In other words, you choose when you want to get this thing up and running. Like you said, Pastor, you can choose not to, too.
I had a question.
Yeah, go ahead.
In regards to interpretation, like Gary said that he does the interpreting in his church.
Yeah, Pastor Gary, yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I have to distinguish here. I'm Gary and Brother Gary.
Oh, yeah,
and
I'm sorry.
Pastor Gary.
Yeah, well, I was thinking about that.
Yeah.
But I mean, he was talking about it, and he mentioned that he does the interpreting. And, you know, like, that's, I think that's one thing that bodies need to know, that there's somebody that's going to interpret, you know.
Yeah.
You know, because if they're going to give a tongue and then they stand there and nobody's going to interpret, you know, they're going to feel real stupid, because if they don't know, you know what I'm saying? If they don't know that there's somebody to interpret, and I praise God, because I'm just trying to get people to bring a message forth in our church. The thing that we're blessed with is we have two interpreters. My wife and I, you know, so just trying to get people to understand that, don't worry, somebody's going to interpret that for you, you know, and I think a lot of people don't realize that, so that, you know, they just keep it under their hat, so to speak.
I've often said this, we could dispense with 3 hours of teaching in a church about how to get tongues interpretation stirred up. All a pastor has to do is every Sunday say, hey, if you have a tongue, I'll interpret it. And that just that erases any doubt that, hey, if I get up and speak in tongues, the pastor's going to interpret. Did you want to add to that, Gary?
Yeah, breakthrough for us was verse 28. Just after he encourages him about speaking in tongues, he says, but if there be no interpreter, let him keep silent in the church. And so on that scripture, then, we're supposed to know who the interpreter is and if he's there. You're supposed to know that. You're not supposed to just cross your fingers and hope somebody's going to interpret. You're supposed to know if there's an interpreter or not. And if there isn't, then you should, it says here, just
says, let him keep silence in the church and let him speak to himself. If you don't know, there's an interpreter. So it's important in the church to make known who the interpreter is. Now, for us, when I saw this scripture, learning from Brother Joe Jordan, it just lit up like a light bulb. God wanted me to interpret. I said, God, I will do this. If you want me to do this, I will do it. Just as a matter of faith, not knowing really much about it, but I figured if he wants me to do it, and if I believe, then that's what's going to happen. And what you have to do, really the pastor should interpret, because he should be the most trusted person in the room. You should feel very safe if the pastor is interpreting. If you don't, I don't know why you go where you're going. But anyway, so that's wholesome. It doesn't have to be. It could be a different person. But the point is this. I had to learn to interpret. And what I found was, I don't think about what I'm going to say while the tongue is given. I wait till it's finished, and then I start talking. And then I find out what I'm going to say as I'm talking. You just have to step out and do that. But God is faithful. God is faithful. And he's always come through.
We're about a half hour into this session. We're going to continue on this, talking about proper order of tongues interpretation in our next session. So stay tuned for this, and praise God, we'll continue on talking about proper order and good order concerning the gifts of the Spirit in the local church. Is there anyone else that has anything to add just before we close this session? If not, we'll see you in the next session. God bless you, and be sure and tune in again. I want to say, too, be sure and subscribe to our channel, and we want other people to know about this. The more people that subscribe, the more it gets distributed throughout YouTube. So God bless you, and we'll see you in a bit.